John Whitaker.
And then can you tell us what years you attended Linda McKinley? How old were you in 71 and what grade were you in?
Yeah. Jesus. Well, in 1971, I was 17 years old. And, I came out, of course, in June of 71. I started in, 1968. Here, Columbus, Ohio. I've lived other places. I lived in Cleveland for a while. I lived out in California, but these were the interim years. These were years after I'd gotten out of high school and gone through some other issues in life. I was drafted into the military because when I got out of school, Vietnam was still going on. Richard Nixon was president, and he was talking this good stuff about ending the war, but he didn't. And they had postponed the draft for a while, thought I was free and clear. I went to Central State University, but I was going to transfer to Ohio State because it would have been more cost effective. But in the interim, they started the draft back up. I didn't realize that. And it's like 2 weeks after I left Central, I got a notice in the mail. Said, greetings, you are hereby inducted into the Armed Forces of the United States. And so there I went. Out of all my friends, I think I was the only one. In fact, they did draft lottery back then, where they would put all these birth dates in a big bowl and reach in and pick out a date. My birth date was number one. I'm the only guy I've ever known who was number one. You know, until I actually got in the military. But I remember telling my friends, there was a group of us and we had gone out to Franklin Park. And I said, man, guess what, I got drafted. And they all started laughing. They busted out laughing. I mean, I was just outdone. I thought it was certain doom, you know, at that time. And I just couldn't believe it. These guys think this is funny. It certainly was not to me, but by the grace of God, here I am.
Indeed, indeed. And just so you know, when I'm not saying anything, I'm listening to you and I'm here with you. Sure. I'm not saying anything because I don't want our voices to overlap because that would mess up the audio. We just need to hear you and not me. Okay. Okay.
Can you hear me clearly?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I can hear you fine. So can you talk a little bit though about earlier in your life, your childhood up to the time when you were in high school, so wow. your early life.
Well, I'm from Columbus. I was born here, raised here. In those days, just about all neighborhoods were segregated. I went to 11th Avenue Elementary School. Me and Don went there together. In fact, I can't think of anybody else that did go to 11th Avenue at that time. But that was during the time when 11th Avenue was changing over racially, you know, at that time. Prior to our being there, or in our later years, 5th, 6th grade, it was mostly white, but it was changing. The whole neighborhood was changing. I went to junior high school on the east side of town. I went to Monroe Junior High. The school itself was only a year old when I went there. It was only its second year of existence. But it was in an all-black neighborhood and a neighborhood that had been traditionally black. So I never got the opportunity to go to school with white kids. Not many. Monroe Junior High and then, of course, Linda McKinley. I used to live on, I lived on St. Clair Avenue right by East 5th. And 5th Avenue was the dividing line. If you lived on the east side of 5th Avenue, you went to Central High School. Or a little farther out, you might have gone to East was some distance away. But if you lived north of Fifth Avenue, you went to London. And it was some distance away from us, but that was it. There were no other choices. So us living on the north side of Fifth Avenue, we of course were going to go to London. And by the time, there are six children in my family. All of us went to London. I have a sister who is older than me. Donald was like 4 years ahead of me. Then there was me. Then I have a brother, 2 years younger, another brother, and two sisters. All of us went to London. So I was like the second one. So, you know, London was, that was it. And we didn't expect anything else or didn't anticipate anything else. And we really didn't have much choice in the matter. Not during those times.
Right. So your Lyndon was in your was a part of your family.
Yeah.
So then can you talk about as a young person, as a youth, what was your awareness of the political and social turmoil that was happening, say in the late '60s, the early '70s, and do you recall if there was any particular event or incident or happening that affected you the most?
Wow. There was an awful lot during that time. This is, you know, when I was at Lyndon, and particularly maybe my 10th or 11th grade year, this was during a time out in Los Angeles. There'd been a large race riot, Detroit. There were several larger cities where there had been racial impasses or racial conflict. That was the mood of the country during that time. Much like now, only it looks a little different now. You know, back then it was all black. And of course, but then, much as now, we were setting our own neighborhoods on fire and destroying our own neighborhoods. But these things were on a larger scale, were happening in larger cities. But it affected all of us, and everybody was mindful of it. And then there were things that happened to us individually. I went to, like I say, Monroe. Monroe was an all-black junior high school in an all-black neighborhood. I will never forget one particular incident where we had a principal. He was, of course, white, and vice principal. His name is Mr. Wilson. I'll never forget him. A little short, stocky white dude. And he beat this black girl up. I mean, he beat her. Beat her down to the ground. But the next day, he's back in school. There was no hue and cry. None of that. I mean, some noise was made, and then the Call and Post existed then. May have been an article or two about her in that paper. But other than that, there's no big deal like it would have been today. That just would not have gone today, you know, for this principal, white, black, or whatever he is, to beat on a student the way this guy beat that girl. But he beat her like a dog, and like I say, was back in school the very next day. So, you know.
How did that affect you?
These are things that affected me very early on. I was very angry about this white man who'd beaten this black girl. But I was unsettled in the school anyway. We had a white principal and vice principal. And regardless of what you went in there to see them for, no matter what you said, you were wrong. And you were ultimately going to face some kind of retribution for whatever the case may be. Thank God I had very understanding parents. And I remember my father and I formed a special bond during that time because we had kind of clashed a little bit. I'm a teenage boy, you know. But I remember my father coming to the school, and they were going to suspend me, and my father told him, no, you're not. I'm looking at him like, what? That's my pop, you know. And they didn't suspend me as a result of my father stepping forward and speaking for me. But that's something that I had to deal with throughout my years in junior high school. Fortunately for us, we had a few black teachers. I remember one in particular, Miss Kent. She was she was a wonderful woman. She's the one who she had gone to Central State, and she talked about Central State so much, I determined I'm going to Central State, and ultimately I did go. But they were the exceptions rather than the rule.
Can you then talk a little bit about Linden as a community when you lived there and how it changed while you were there, if it changed while you were living there as a student, as a high school student, and then also if you felt racial tension in the community?
Boy, did we. It was a community, the entire community in transit. That area, I remember, like I said, I have a sister who's like 4 years older than me. I'll never forget one day she came home just bawling, crying crocodile tears, because some white guys had chased a black guy from Linden and just beat him. But by the time I'm going to Linden, that had changed over. I think my 10th grade year in Linden, Linden was maybe about 60% black. By my senior year, Linden was 90+% black. So the neighborhood, the whole community, was changing over very, very quickly. I remember a time when you couldn't, if you were black, you couldn't walk past 17th Avenue. You know, if you cross 17th Avenue, you're in dangerous territory because it was all white. But in a very few short years, it's all black. Just that, you know, it seemed as fast as white people moved out, black people moved in. And it happened in a very short period of time that the whole community was changing. And this was during that time when that whole area was in transit.
So at the time when you were at Linden, you were a part of a group of students. I think Mr. Vassar referred to it as the Black Student Union. And you all met regularly outside of school. And so my understanding is you met at John Wells' house and at Al Young's house. Can you talk a little bit about that group and why you were meeting and what your goals were?
I don't remember so much meeting over Al's house. I do remember meeting over Johnny Wells' house. Johnny Wells lived with his uncle. And his uncle was very active with us. And he allowed us to meet at his home. And I guess you would say he advised us in some capacity. He was very much interested in the things that we were doing and the things that we were involved in. And his house is fairly close to Linden. He didn't live very far away from school. And so we met over there an awful lot. I don't remember meeting at Al's. I don't. I mean, it's possible that they did, but I don't recall that. But.
And so can you talk about when you did meet at John Wells' house, why were you there? Why were you meeting outside? I mean, you know, you took the time to meet outside of school, so it must have been important. Why were you meeting? What did you all talk about? What did you want to do?
Well, we talked about the things that were going on in school. I remember, you know, my 10th and 11th grade years are not particularly memorable. I was working. And so I tried to be in that building as little as possible because I worked at night. I didn't get off until like 1 o'clock in the morning. I worked at Riverside Hospital. But my senior year was somewhat different. And we all became more acclimated to political issues and some of the things that were going on in the school, some of the things that we saw as being unfair. I remember we formed our own separate student council. We had our own black student council president, vice president, so on and so forth. I would take a couple of guys and we would patrol the halls of the school. And what we would do is shadow the current student government, student council president, to see the kind of things that they were doing because we felt that they were unfair. Because they would pick out black students accuse them of this, that, or the other, or cause them difficulty. And we decided to make it a point that we'd be present when this was going on. so that for whatever reason you're accosting this student, we want to know. And we would try to diffuse that. It kind of developed over the year. As I think about it, it developed in a hurry. I heard Don talking about how when they brought Mr. Brown on, I think they brought him to Linden strictly because he was black and for no other reason. Initially, when he came to Linden, he was kicking butts out of school left and right. He threatened me, you know, to kick me out of Linden McKinley. I can't even remember why, but I got that threat. He said something about, well, you want to go to Central or some crap like that. But as the year progressed, his attitude changed. But initially, he was an enforcer. And I think that was the sole purpose in having him there, because he was a black man. And he came in like an enforcer. He was kicking people out of school left and right and threatening to do so. But as the year progressed, his attitude changed toward us. They saw that we were an organized group of students. We weren't just a rabble. And I remember we used to meet in the teacher's lounge with them frequently. Like I said, I remember Mr. Brown's attitude changing, just totally. There were a couple of other, Gary Davis, Bruce Bunch. Mr. Davis, that was my guy. That was my guy. He was an extremely intelligent young man. And he was very sympathetic to us because we weren't that far apart in age. He was like in his early 20s then. So it was Bruce Bunch. He had a lot of wisdom to impart to us. And I always enjoyed talking with him. I actually had him for a teacher in some classes.
And can you talk a little bit about how their presence in the school, the presence of Mr. Davis and Bruce Bunch and later, I guess, Tom Brown, affected black students? And also, could you talk a little bit about how Mr. Brown's approach or his perspective changed from an enforcer to what?
To someone sympathetic to our views and to our viewpoint. He was willing to listen. You could sit back across the room and watch him and watch the expressions on his face, how they had changed from, like I say, early that school year. I remember that guy threatening to kick me out of school. He changed totally toward the end of the school year. And like I say, he was very sympathetic and willing to listen. He sponsored these groups that we had in the teacher's lounge. You know, this was at his behest. And the year certainly didn't start out that way. They realized that we were serious and that we were not some young high school dummies running around. It was an organized effort. I'm always amazed at that we were able to meet as we did and organize to the extent that we did. I think a lot of people didn't really want to believe that, but we did. We actually did.
Can you tell us a little bit about some of the other students who were part of the group? So Valora Washington, John Harrington, Mark Morton, Mr. Vassar, we know right there, and Al Young. What were these students like? What were these kids like? And can you talk a little bit about your role in the group and how you were maybe different than some of the others, particularly the other John Wells?
Well, like I said, me and Vassar went back a long time. We were in elementary school together, so I'd known him for a long time. Johnny Harrington, that was my best partner. We lived a couple streets over from each other. So we were just, I guess you could say we were just regular kids at the time. We just became involved in some things that actually were bigger than us. And we matured a lot during that period of time. There were several students that had an interest in student government. Like I said, we formed our own student government. There was an elected student class president, all that good stuff. But we felt that they were tools of the school administration. And so we formed our own. We felt we were truly representative of the student body, which at that time had changed and become black. Lyndon hadn't been that way, but now it was. Say my senior year, Lyndon was 90% black. If that ain't all black, I don't know what is. It was a big change for the school, for the whole community. That whole community had changed over. It was a black community now. It wasn't all white anymore, as it were.
So I'm interested in, and I want to go back to that in a second, but I'm interested in this group dynamic. Some of the people that we've spoken to have talked in particular about the relationship between you and John Wells.
Oh my goodness.
What they described was it sounded a little bit like fire and ice.
And it was.
Did you talk to that a little bit?
It was exactly that. Fire and ice. Listen, I need to use the restroom, dear. Can I run to the restroom? I'll be right back.
Sure. Yes. Sure. Okay.
All right, we're going to pause the recording, and then we'll get it back on when he comes back. Great interview, Celia. Great. So engaging.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
Trying to not let these damn cats drive me crazy.
But you know what I really loved that you tackled it? I was writing a follow-up question, you asked it. When he said, from enforcer to what? And then you asked that question, I was writing, and I wrote in brackets, ally question mark. I thought that was going to be really interesting, and I think it is. So Tom Brown changed.
Yeah, that's really, it's very interesting. You know, it's very interesting because he's not the first one to talk. Somebody else mentioned his earlier, you know, perspective. So.
Mm-hmm. Good stuff, no problem. Please do have a look at the footage that we uploaded. So hopefully Scott and Paul can do a little mitigation on the audio and video. The video looks good, but some is darker. We got about, I think it's 4 to 6 clips, I think it is. 6 total.
So you're saying the stuff that was in the house was darker?
Well, not that's so it's dark, but you can see it's a lot warmer. So yes, dark, but there's a lot more hints of red and brown in the color.
Oh,
and you can see everyone clearly. Yeah, you know what I mean? So it's really warm, and I think we could do some things to brighten it up potentially.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I edited in Premiere Pro. There's definitely, you can do color correction and do a lot. You can also brighten it as well if that's needed.
Good. I'm a little worried about the Harrington stuff. He looks really good, but he is in front of that window. Even though we have the red drapes curtain in between him and the lights diffused, it's warm and it's clear, but I'd love it if he could pop a little bit more. But you'll see, you know, you may have different opinions too, so I'm curious to see what you guys think. And then, of course, we've got all no passes, unfortunately. Scott just wrote me, so we won't be able to get the parking passes from Patty. So I could...
I have Candace checking. She said she's checking about reimbursement or, yeah.
Okay. Well, I'm going to go ahead and turn off video and begin the recording again, okay?
Okay, thanks. Okay, Mr. Whitaker,
yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can. I'm sorry about that.
No worries. So you were starting to talk about the relationship between you and John Wells and Fire and Ice.
It was that. We ultimately got to be pretty good friends. And like I say, his family lived not too far from the school, and we met over his house. He lived with his uncle. His family was from Michigan, which is where he resides at now. But he lived with his uncle, and we all got to be pretty good friends over a period of time. But we were like fire and ice. Johnny was always radical. Johnny always wanted to do the things that would bring the most attention to both himself and our movement. And I was more, well, let's think about that. You know, we need to think this through. We need to have a plan, not just some wild radical reaction. And Johnny was popular. Johnny could always marshal a group of people to his cause. A lot of these people were not thinking about what the plan was. It was just chaos for the sake of chaos. And I was just always totally against that. You know, as far as I was concerned, there always needed to be a plan. We always needed to have a plan of action, you know, and a plan that followed all the way through from start to finish. Donnie, he was for doing things, like right now, you know, things that just brought attention sometimes without any plan about what to do with this attention, just for the sake of doing so. And so we clashed an awful lot, but I would always try to, I had to always try to cool Johnny down. You know, slow down, man. Think about what you're doing, what you're gonna do, why we're doing what.
So when you look back at the group and the things that you did and the things that you achieved, would you say that ultimately you complimented each other?
Yes. Amazingly so, all of us. That's another thing that was just amazing about that group of young people, is the way that we did complement each other and strengthen each other, and it made us stronger as a group, and it made us seek purpose in what we were doing. You know, we weren't just doing it just to be doing it. We weren't going to make a bunch of noise. We didn't want to just tear up the school, although sometimes it seemed like Johnny Wells might have wanted to. he was just that kind of guy, you know, and that was his personality at the time. And you know, do something. Let's tear something up. Well, you know, and my thing was always, well, then what? You know, number one, what are we tearing it up for? And then number two, what are we going to do after we've done this? And it was amazing. I think, and not to brag, but I think we were an amazing group of young people. You know, first of all, nobody expected anything like that from any of us. We were just young high school knuckleheads. They didn't take us seriously until it got to that point. You know, where things kind of like came out in the open. You know, and even then they were trying to, you know, brush us aside. But we were satisfied with the effort that we made.
So I want to start off early in 1971 in February. Were you at the Black History Week performance, the play that,
yes,
that Mr. Bassett was in?
Yes.
And can you describe from your perspective what happened and describe what you saw, describe how you felt?
Well, I was on the stage also. I wasn't part of the performance, but I read a poem. And I remember being on that stage, and we're in the auditorium, and we have an auditorium in a balcony, and then suddenly these papers just flew down from the balcony. And I remember seeing the guy take off running. But I did read one of the papers. And what it was about primarily was white students advocating for their own separate graduation ceremony. They wanted to have theirs unto themselves, no blacks, just them. That's what that, I picked one of them up and I read it. And that's what it basically said, what it advocated. The guy that threw him over the balcony, I didn't know him. Quite honestly, I didn't know very many white people at Linden. I you know, maybe that's my fault, I don't know. But I just didn't and had no interest in doing so. And I had been in all black schools all of my life. Linden was, by the time I went, was no different. But it was quite a shock. This guy threw these things over the balcony and then took off. And, you know, like Don said, they said he had a car up front waiting for him. I know nobody caught up to him. But I remember looking at one of the flyers, and they were advocating for a separate graduation ceremony for the white students. And that's what it was about. It was kind of shocking.
How did you feel when you saw that, when you read that, and you know, what were your immediate thoughts and feelings? And then also, can you tell us what was happening in the room or in the auditorium around you?
Well, I mean, the auditorium was, everybody in the auditorium was as confused as I was. Nobody knew what was happening. Nobody knew what this was, what it was for, what it was about. They were enjoying the performance on stage. And then suddenly these papers rained down. And everybody was like, what? What is this? Because, like I said, at that time, Linda was mostly black. A lot of us were wondering, what white folks? You know, where are they? Because Lyndon was over 90% black at the time. There just weren't that many. And it just it struck us all as strange that this guy would do this. We didn't understand what or why. I think a lot of people kind of brushed it off not long after that. It's not something that they seriously considered for any length of time. It was an anomaly. You know, it's not something we would have expected to happen in a million years. And like me, a lot of us are like, who's he talking about? Because this Lyndon's all black, as far as we were concerned. It pretty much was, except for a very small number. Our discontent was not with the students or the student body. It was with the administration of the school. And the ways in which the school was being administered. You know, it wasn't with, there was no clash of students because, like I say, by that time, Lyndon was mostly black. So they're just, you know, it came as a big surprise to all of us. But yeah, I remember that day that kid threw that stuff over. Man, it was just a shock to everybody. And you picked up the fly and you looked at it and like, what is this?
So I want to piggyback on something that you said. The fact that Lyndon was mostly black at that point, and that's your perception of it, how did that affect, I mean, I understand the connection in my mind, but I would like for you to talk about how that affected the things that this black student union wanted. Because it's a different, you know, when you hear that you wanted these things, you wanted representation in the school, et cetera. Can you talk about how the fact that the student body was mostly black, you know, influenced that?
Oh, totally. It was because the student body was mostly black. Lyndon had previously been an all-white school, but things had changed. Just like the neighborhood had previously been all-white, it was now black. Black people in large numbers started moving north in Columbus in a very short period of time. So almost as soon as white folks moved out of a house, black folks moved in. And this took place over a very short period of time. We felt like we weren't being represented. We weren't being listened to. We just weren't being counted at all. And we decided to have a voice of our own. And like I said, they had the student council president, vice president, whatever. But I remember we formed our own. I remember it was myself and maybe a group of two or three other people. They used to patrol the halls and be looking for stuff. So we started patrolling the patrol. When they went out, walk around the hallways, we're right here with you. So whatever you accost somebody for, we're going to get to the bottom of it. What's the point? Why are you doing this? Why are you accosting this young man or young woman or whatever? Because like I said, we had our own student council. And we felt we were more representative of the student body as a whole. And as things turned out, we were. We were. We were looked to by the student body, asked questions. They didn't even bother with the formerly, quote-unquote, elected student body. They just were unimportant and pretty soon became a non-entity.
take part in the march from Lyndon McKinley to Franklin Park?
Oh, yes. Yes.
On Malcolm X's birthday?
Yeah, the whole school did.
Can you talk about that journey and then what it was like when you got there to Franklin Park?
I mean, it was amazing. We walked from Lyndon McKinley High School all the way down Cleveland Avenue downtown and then down Broad Street to Franklin Park. I remember when we passed East, the only all-black school in the city, we're waving to them. They're in the classrooms waving out the windows. We're walking toward Franklin Park. They were not allowed to come out of the building. But we had done this thing, and like I said, it was pretty much the whole school. School just dismissed for the day because everybody left, and we all walked. We were all very, I remember being very proud and being very happy that when I looked around, all I saw were students from Lyndon McKinley, people riding down the streets, blowing horns at us, all that good stuff. And we got to the park. It was like a picnic, you know, on that particular day. I didn't expect it, but I was very pleased that it took place the way that it did. We never understood the power that we had. We really didn't. I mean, for a group of students to be able to marshal the whole school to leave and walk clear across town, that was a powerful thing. We just never understood it as such at the time. We were just happy. You know, happy that the people followed us, that they did, you know, in the way that they did. And this was, it wasn't just a local thing. It was about things that were going on in the country. It wasn't just Lyndon McKinley, Columbus, Ohio. This is going on all over the United States, much like now. When you think about it.
Yes. So can you talk about at that time in 71 when you were doing, when this whole student body is marching toward the park to celebrate Malcolm X's birthday, can you talk about how national politics informed that? And also, can you say when you got to the park for this rally, was it worth it? What was the payoff when you got there? What was it like?
I mean, to me, it was worth it. Just the fact that we gathered and we were able to walk from Lyndon and unaccosted. You know, the police didn't stop us. They didn't bother with us. They stayed on the sidelines and watched for the most part. I'm sure, not knowing what to do. I'm sure there was some of them, if they had their way, they'd have just busted heads and broke the whole thing up. But they didn't. And we were able to carry on that entire march. Like I said, the weight of it didn't occur to me at the time. It just, you know, it didn't occur to me how big a thing this was. But it was not just the mood of those of us in Lyndon or in Columbus, Ohio. It was nationwide, you know, during that time frame. And much like now. You know, it wasn't in one place. That's like now, you know, things are going on in cities all across America. And even in the midst of this pandemic or whatever, you know, black folks are tired. And we're tired of the same treatment. I mean, here we are. What I'm talking about happened 50 years ago. It's 50 years later and the same kinds of things are going on. But we were thrilled. And like I said, I don't think I know I didn't realize how big this was, you know, at that particular point in time. And the powers that be just wanted to play us off as little knucklehead high school kids. But some of them understood that it was more than that. And the issues were bigger than that. And we were more deeply involved than just to raise little Cain. We had a purpose, and we were steadfast in that. And you know, you mentioned that group of people that we had come together. It's just, it's amazing that we came together as we did. were able to share our views and present the points that we did. You know, instead of it being a room full of kids arguing, we were young people with a purpose. And even though everybody had their own separate viewpoint, we were able to come together and present a united front. That was amazing. Wow, when I think back on it, yeah.
Indeed, indeed. Can you describe that rally to the best of your recollection? Rally in the park.
When we walked down to Franklin Park?
Yeah, when you got to the park, what was happening in the park?
I mean, we just enjoyed the park. People laughing and talking and having discussions. There were no great speeches that I recall. Few people spoke. But nothing strikes my memory. To me, the more memorable thing was the actual walk itself, was the fact that nearly the entire school walked down to Franklin Park. You know, there were very few people that didn't participate. That's, to me, was the more memorable aspect of it. I don't even remember what took place after it was all over with. We all broke up and went on back about our business. But it was the act of walking as a group to begin with, you know, from the very start, and in unison. There was no inviting, no, none of that. We were a unified group, the entire school. I think that empowered us. Made me feel like we're on the right track. We're going in the right direction. We are influencing people. I didn't want to get too self-important, but it made me feel good. Made me feel like I was involved in something that was representative, not just of me and the small group of people that I dealt with, but with the whole school. Everybody felt the same way. And we were able to express it. It was a great day.
It's very powerful. Hearing you describe it is very powerful.
I mean, when I sit back and I think about it now, we'd never seen anything like that in Columbus up to that point. And I don't think we have since.
So I'm going to move forward a little bit in the month and ask you about the meeting that took place at Bethel AME Church on the evening of May 24th. Were you at that meeting?
No, I wasn't. No. Okay. Unfortunately, Bethel was my church. My uncle was the pastor. It's a church I attended, but I happened not to be there that evening. I live some distance away from Linden. Fifth Avenue was a dividing line. I lived just over Fifth Avenue. So it was quite some ways away from my home. So it wasn't a simple matter for me to trot up to Linden and be there. Johnny Wells, like I say, lived right up there in the neighborhood. So
can you talk about your memories of the flag being switched and the red, black, and green flag being raised at Linda McKinley High School?
I wasn't aware that it had been. I found out later that Don Basser was the one who put the flag up. I mean, I was glad of it. We had big posters we placed in the hallways, and to me that was the height of representation. The Black Nationalist flag, come on. I was very glad and proud that had taken place. You know, it just showed me the mindset of the student body. You know, not one or two people, but the whole student body. I don't know anybody that wasn't in agreement with that. I don't know anybody who would not have wanted to see that happen. I think everybody in the whole school was just very proud and glad, and the act itself unified us as a group. The black student body. It was, wow. It was an unusual time.
So, can you talk about the next day? There was an assembly that was called, an unauthorized assembly that was called. And were you at that assembly?
I'm trying to remember if I was or not.
if you don't recall that, then we can move directly to the police raid.
Oh, geez.
And what happened then? So if you could talk, you know, sort of talk about, if you don't recall the assembly itself, when the police came into the school and what was happening before, to the best of your memory, what was happening before they came into the school and then what happened. And I know I'm getting kind of dark because the light in here changed. I'm just going to open the curtains, but I can hear you.
Okay. Yeah, I can't talk about what took place in the school auditorium. I do remember the day that they closed the school very, very, very well. And everybody has different experiences of that day. You know, like Don was telling you, he was in the school building. I wasn't in the building. I had come outside and I was out in right in front of the school, right in front of the door. Like I say, everybody's experiences were different. I was considered, I think, at the time, one of the leaders of the black student movement at that time, so people knew me. And I'm standing right in front of the school door. I did not see all of the police mounting up, because what they had done is the police had come in numbers and were up in the community to come into the school. We had no knowledge of this. They were just up in that Linden area, very near Linden, in large groups, ready to invade the school, as it were. And we didn't know this. To us, it's a regular school day. To me, like a lot of other students, I'm scuffling so I can graduate. You know, I needed points. And I was concerned about being able to graduate on time, as were a lot of other people, you know, with everything else that was going on. And I somehow ended up standing in front of the school, had some books in my hand. All of a sudden, door bust open. And here comes, I can't remember the guy's name. This kid named Buttons. And the police had him, and they had his arm behind his back. He looked at me, he said, "Help me, Whit." I couldn't not help him. I'm supposed to be one of the student leaders. I couldn't just stand there. So I threw my book down, and I ran and I dived on one of the police and grabbed him. And we wrestled from that door out to the front of the school. And the police were as scared as we were. They didn't know what to expect. I don't know what they thought was going to take place when they came up there. But when I grabbed that guy, it was like, oh, man, you could see the fright in his eyes. And we're wrestling around on the ground. Somehow he got the one arm free with the nightstick. And he swung it back over his shoulders and he cut me in the forehead. I still got a scar. And I started bleeding, and there were some students out in front of the school. They ran up and grabbed me, you know, because my head was bleeding. But as soon as I let him go, the policeman go, he took off. What about him pursuing me? Like I say, they were as scared as we were, if not more so, you know, because they didn't know what was going to happen. I don't think a lot of them even knew what they were there for. But this had been their plan. And so a couple of students grabbed me. One guy took his jacket off, Sidney Custer, I think it was, wrapped it all around my head. I couldn't see. They ran me through some alleys. I ended up over at Sidney's house, and they washed the blood off my head. Ultimately, I made it home. But I found out once I got home that they had arrested several people. Stanley Wilder, he was a friend of mine. They had beat Stanley up and accosted him in the school hallways, arrested him. I don't know what happened to Don. Like I said, people were going every which way. There were some of us outside, some of us in the building. It was complete bedlam, but it was planned. And like I say, we didn't know that. The police had marshaled their forces just a little north of the school. And it was their plan to come, you know, to invade Linda McKinley that day. We had no idea, no knowledge of this until it actually happened. And it was just complete chaos, you know, on that particular day. Like I said, we weren't anticipating it. I'm thinking about trying to graduate. You know, I was afraid I might not. A confrontation with the police. They fomented that whole thing.
So one is, how do you think, or why do you think it was a plan? It was such a coordinated plan. And secondly, how did you feel once you realized that it was a coordinated plan? I mean, you know, when you're seeing all of these things happen and then you hear about what's happened later, how did that hit you?
Well, I think, number one, it began because the powers that be got fed up with us, you know, because we turned Lyndon into a black school. They didn't like that. They didn't like that at all. I think they felt like we had no right to do that. We were supposed to just be quiet and quietly go on about our business, and that they were upset about some of the things that had taken place. We had a safety director at that time. His name was, Jim Hughes, I think. And he was trying to be politically known, or known throughout the city. He's the one who ordered that, and ordered all of those police to come up to Lyndon. And they just decided that, please excuse my language, but it seems to me they decided we're gonna take care of these little niggas now. And this was the plan that they formed. I remember when I found out that all those police had been up at the school, I was extremely angry. You know, that they had planned such a thing. And we had no idea. Most students were like me, concentrating on graduating. That was the thing that was foremost in my mind, getting my grades together so I can get out of here. I was a senior. I wanted to graduate. I wasn't thinking about anything else. And then here's the Columbus Police Department. And like I say, the safety director, I think his name was Jim Hughes. And he, of course, there were a lot of other factors that were involved in this. This guy was trying to be known in the city. And he was going to be the one to resolve all this. You know what I mean? And this was his way of demonstrating his power by involving the Columbus Police Department with a group of high school students. They weren't doing anything. We weren't harming anybody. We weren't tearing anything up. We never did. We never, at least, I know, you know, there were times when Johnny Wells wanted to burn the school down or tear this up or tear that up. But I always was able to talk them out of that because it was pointless. And to me, it would have caused more problems than it solved. So we didn't tear up anything. We didn't harm anyone. We went to great lengths to make sure that those kind of things didn't happen. We were dead on that. We wanted to make sure that they weren't going to take place. I was listening to Don talk, and it just wasn't in him, to allow them to burn the American flag. You know, he didn't let that happen. You know what I mean? Because that wasn't his nature. And for the most part, it wasn't our nature to seek violence. Like I said, there were a couple of people that, you know, Johnny Wells mainly, who would have wanted to. And he certainly had a following in the school that would have, if he decided to burn the school down, they would have been right with him. But that was not our purpose and not our point. And I'm glad that we didn't do anything like that. It didn't come to that. But with all those police being up there, it came as a total shock to me. And I was really surprised when I found out what had taken place in the school, because I was outside of the building, and some people had, you know, once I got hit in my head and blood everywhere, I couldn't see. And I remember Sidney Custer, just, oh man, you let him tell it, I was half dead. He was, oh my goodness, threw his jacket over my head, and they whisked me away. So I didn't know what was going on after that. I didn't find that out until later in the day, that people had gone to jail, that the police were all up in the school. I didn't know, you know, until like the following day. And then it started to dawn on me that this was their plan. They had come prepared to do this. It wasn't going to be a regular school day, no matter what went on. They were going to do this.
Would you describe this experience as traumatic.
Oh, indeed. Oh, my goodness, yes. Yeah, because it came as a complete surprise. We had no idea. Like I say, they had police saturating the neighborhood. Police were poised, you know, from early that morning to invade Linden, in effect. We had no idea. We didn't know this. But they had been ready. There was a plan. And this was their plan. And this is how it went down. And like I told you, the cops were as scared as some of us were. Now, I jumped on a cop. You know, he came out the door and he had that boy's arms all up behind his back. He looked at me, he said, help me with, what could I do? I had to. I had to act. I threw my books down and jumped on this cop. And when I grabbed that cop, he was frightened to death. He was scared. And I didn't know what I'm gonna do with him. We wrestled down to the front of the school building. He somehow got that club out and hit me in my head. And then it was just, for me, chaos after that. And, you know, by the grace of God, I got away with the help of some other students. But it was a totally chaotic scene, both outside and inside of the school.
And this was after students were killed at Kent State. And so did you, later, after the fact, did you ever think about how differently things could have gone? You know, with that level of police presence, first of all, with the coordinated plan, and they're all there with weapons and the gear, but also the fact that you got into it, you jumped on a cop. Did you think about how, after?
Oh, boy. Afterward, yes. I most certainly thought about it. I questioned myself. I'm like, man, what's wrong with you? Have you lost your mind? You jumped on the police. I asked myself a lot of those questions. It never occurred to me to compare it to Kent State. To me, it was a different set of circumstances. Almost entirely, although maybe if you step back and look at it, maybe there were some similarities. But that never crossed my mind. I had all kinds of thoughts, regrets, some ideas about some things I could have done differently, all those kinds of things after it was over with.
Can you talk about the rest of the school year then and how that played out, including your graduation?
We didn't have a graduation, more or less, okay? The rest of the school year, the school stayed closed pretty much the rest of the year. Until maybe the very last day. Let me tell you something. Everyone in my senior class graduated. They didn't fail anybody. They wanted us out of there. So even if you were failing, you're getting out of here. Nobody failed. Every single person in my senior class graduated from Linda McKinley that year. We were, of course, marked after that. You go somewhere and you're trying to get a job. And they say, well, where'd you graduate high school? You say, Linda McKinley. It's like, that's the kind of black mark that we got. It was very, very difficult to get a job in this area. Fortunately for me, I went to school right after that. Went to Central State. So it wasn't so much an issue. But I talked to a lot of friends who had big time problems trying to get a job. And it was because of them having mentioned that they'd been to Linda McKinley. We were black marked. And like I said, our whole senior class, everybody, there was not one person who didn't graduate from Linda McKinley that year. They graduated the entire, have you ever heard of anything like that? The entire senior class, because they wanted them out of there. And then when they began the school year, the next year they tried to more or less paper over what had taken place. I remember I had a brother that was right behind me, and they just never mentioned it. I remember our school librarian, Ms. Jacobson, and everybody loved Ms. J and thought she was so kind and wonderful. But the very next year, Miss J is talking like it didn't happen. And that just told me totally against her. I thought, you can at least be honest. But they didn't want to mention the graduating class of 1971, like we didn't exist. They wanted to erase it totally.
Why do you think it was?
Because they know they'd made some mistakes, and but they also knew that it had, to a degree, we had some popularity in the city. They most certainly wanted to dispel that. They didn't want to stir up the city, so to speak. So again, they kept trying to downplay us as some discontent high school kids. I remember Charles Ross became involved. He wasn't up there that day. He had not been up there before. He was involved in his own affairs down on this campus, on the OSU campus. But he did come up there right afterwards. He did at least show some interest and some willingness to talk to it, to us. He wasn't necessarily my hero because his focus was the Ohio State University campus, not us. But he did at least take enough interest to come up into that Linden area. But very shortly after that, the focus went from us to Charles Wright and the police commissioner. They started having it out. And then they had this trial of Charles Ross down at that transportation building on Broad Street. And they made a big deal out of that. And we kind of got lost in the shuffle after that time. But our issues were real to us. And certainly more real than some trial with Charles Ross that we didn't have anything to do with. We really didn't think he was the great leader that he espoused himself to be. He was a leader here on this OSU campus, but beyond that, out in the city, it's not like people were paying a lot of attention to him or following anything that he said. And we were people of the community. He involved himself. We didn't invite him. We didn't, I don't mean to talk down on anyone, but this is the way I saw it. He came and involved himself. We didn't invite him. We didn't ask for his leadership. We didn't ask for his help. But there he was. And like I say, the focus of everything shifted from us to him very shortly thereafter.
But while you were at Linden, while you were a student, and while you were involved with this Black Student Union, is it fair to say that you all were self-directed and that you were leading yourselves?
Yes, indeed. We didn't have any adult counsel. There were no adults that were wholeheartedly, you know, there may have been a few from within the community, you know, who would talk to us. I suppose they were trying to calm us down. But for the most part, they wanted to look at us as high school kids. It just didn't occur to them that high school kids could organize to the extent that we did and carry these things out, you know, with such an organization as we did. I think it shocked them, and they didn't want to believe it. They didn't want to believe it was possible, much less that it was happening. You know, and until after everything came to fore, did any of them step back and say, oh, wow, these kids are serious. You know, and they meant what they said.
So can you talk about how the events at Linda McKinley in 71, and maybe even before that, but particularly that year, how did that affect your pathway forward after high school?
Oh, wow. It was a tumultuous time, period. Like I said, the war was still going on. Richard Nixon postponed it, but he didn't end it. And being of draft age, that was always on my mind. So that was one of the thoughts uppermost in my mind. Aside from that, I'm going to school. I'm going to an all-black school. It was much smaller. We were commenting on that today than this campus. In fact, I think you could fit Central State in the corner of this school and forget about it. But Central State was a different world. It was an all-black school. One of the problems there was that there were groups from various cities. A Cincinnati group, a Cleveland group, a Dayton group, and they all mobbed up together. There were fraternities that people were ultra interested in becoming a part of. I remember one day walking across campus and I saw some guys pledging and some of the things they had them doing. I'm like, no, I don't think so. I think I'm going to leave that well enough alone. There was also the fact that Central State and Wilberforce, the campuses were practically joined because at one point in time it had been all Wilberforce and they sold out half the school to the state. But the campuses were not separated by much. I mean, you cross the street and you're in Wilberforce. But there was a big contest, more or less, between the two schools. You know, if you went to Central State, you don't go on church side. We called it stateside and church side. And if you were, you went to Central State, you better not cross that street and go on the church side and vice versa. And those kind of things going on. And these were the things that were occupying my mind and my time very shortly after graduating high school. So, like I say, I had talked to some people who had had some problems getting work in Columbus because of having come from Lenny McKinley in the year 1971. But I wasn't one of them because I wasn't here. I was in school. You know, my concern, like I say, the war was still going on. I was very much concerned about my draft status. And like I say, back then they had the draft lottery where they put everybody's birthday in a big bowl, and just reached in and pulled out a date and there you were. And my draft lottery number was number one. Number one, I couldn't believe that. So I was destined to go. And once they reinstated the draft, I think I left Central State, I was gonna come back here, transfer to here, Ohio State. It wasn't 2 weeks before I got this big letter in the mail. Greetings, you are hereby inducted into the Armed Forces of the United States. And I was scared to death because the war was going on. But by the grace of God, here I am, all in one piece.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I guess I'm gonna ask it a little bit different way. Would you say that your experiences at Lyndon and in 71 affected who you are as a person, who you became as a person?
Oh, yes.
And can you talk about that a little bit?
Well, it solidified some of the views that I had. That there was, there never had been a question in terms of race and race relations. Been black all my life. Always lived in a black neighborhood. Always went to black schools. But that just helped to solidify it. You know, who I was. It helped to solidify the views I had in regard to race and race relations. Things were very much the same when I was in the military. Black soldiers hung with black soldiers. Black soldiers were in units together. You know, it was like there was an intentional segregation of the races. We didn't do that. This was the powers that be that put all blacks. I remember being in a couple of companies that were all black. This is the Army, for goodness sakes. But I was in Echo Company. They're all black, practically. And Delta Company, they're practically all black. So it was something that continued throughout my life. And my experiences at Lyndon just strengthened my resolve and helped to solidify my attitudes and behavior. I can't
hear you. Myself. Could you ask Mr. Vassar to turn the phone off? Because that audio is coming into your audio.
Okay.
So anything that's happening in there, we're picking it up. But if it happens when you're talking, then we might not be able to use it.
Yeah, he put it out in another room.
against police brutality and racial violence that are happening in the United States, that have been happening this year in the United States and also around the world. Can you talk a little bit about your thoughts when you see that stuff? Does it bring back memories? Do you see yourself in that? Do you, you know, what are your thoughts, your feelings?
Well, I don't know. I'm a little old now, but pretty much the same as they were then. What is disappointing to me and a little surprising is that things are the way they are. We're talking 50 years later. You know, these things we're talking about of our senior year in high school, that was 50 years ago. Yet here are black people in America fighting the same fight, dealing with the same issues. Those haven't changed. But, you know, they were the same then as they are now. The difference now is that there may be, there are more people listening. And there's some people that are involved that weren't, you know, back during that time. I mean, but just the idea that it is the same thing. I mean, it really is. And that's amazing to me. It made me stop and have to think about that, how things have not changed. How here we are 50 years later, and these are the same issues that we were concerned with this. Because like I say, even during those times when we were in high school, that wasn't just a result of us at Lyndon McKinley just deciding to do all of these things. This is nationwide. There had been, you know, Los Angeles, Detroit. The nation was aflame, and the nation was embroiled in conflict on a racial basis. So it wasn't something that just came out of the blue. But here we are 50 years later, the same issues. That is just ridiculous. Like I say, now there's some people involved that weren't involved then. There are a lot of young white people that are involved now that haven't been. I've been watching the news, and they show the people like downtown Columbus, and I see a lot more white faces. In fact, more white faces than black. That's different. But it's the same argument. It's the same reasons. People got fed up for the same reasons 50 years later. That's, I don't know. I want to see some change. I have grandchildren now, and my concern is for my children and my grandchildren. And my children are grown. I got a daughter in her middle 40s and a son in his 30s, but they both have children. And I'm very much concerned about my grandchildren and the world they're growing up into. I want to see some change, but I have no idea what shape that change will take. I know it'll be different, but I'm not sure what kind of difference, and I'm a little concerned about that, and I'm a little concerned about them. I won't be around when they, you know, come of age and are able to get out and fight their own battles with this, but I'm worried about that. I'm very worried about it.
What do you see as a way forward for resolution or for solution?
I mean, there are some people. There are some people calling for resolution, and working toward resolution. And I don't mean to get political on you, but if we don't get Donald Trump out of that White House, we better. Donald Trump will be the destruction of the United States as we know it, if he's allowed to continue as the commander in chief. How did he get there in the first place? It was a big mistake that he ended up in the White House to begin with. I think that during the time that he was running for office, a lot of sexism played into that. And there were a lot of forces that did not want a Hillary Clinton as a female president. Sexism, pure and simple. And that allowed Donald Trump to ease in there. And then a lot of people just didn't vote. That was hurtful. But he's got to go. He's a danger. A danger, not just a bad president. He's a danger to this country and the people in it. And it is time for him to get out of it. And Biden, he's not necessarily my favorite presidential candidate. But I'd vote for him. I'd vote for a former Republican before I'd vote for Donald Trump. George Bush, put him back up there. I'd give him my vote before I'd vote for Donald Trump. Donald Trump is a danger, and a danger to this country. Donald Trump's concern is Donald Trump. Nothing more. I mean, let's get him gone. So I'm concerned about that. Look at his responses in the race in the face of the racial strife that we've had in this country. His big thing is call out the National Guard. He's not concerned one little bit with what's upsetting to black folks, what the problems are. He hasn't once mentioned any of it. His thing has been to get the National Guard out into the streets of the cities to combat this. Really? Come on, man. No resolution at all. It's never once crossed his lips. He's a danger. He needs to be gone. I didn't mean to get all political on you guys. But.
No, that's fine. That's fine. We want to hear what you have to say. I mean, you know, absolutely. You talk. This is a president who referred to neo-Nazis as very fine people. So
okay.
You know,
and I'm so anti-Trump, and I speak to my ex-wife a lot. Now, we got a fairly good relationship. Now, this woman and I were together for over 20 years. We got a son in his 30s. She lives around the corner from me, so we still see each other a lot. But she is a staunch Republican, believe it or not. And she always has been. I remember when we were younger, and we go in the barbershop. Now, you know, it's mostly men in the barbershop. And boy, she says something about being a Republican. Oh my God, I used to have to defend her physically. You know, like, hold it, man, back up. Back up, that's mine. Sit on down, you know, cut out all that noise. She got the right to say what she thinks. And that's the way our relationship has always been. Even to the point today where we won't talk about presidential politics because she's a Republican and she weakly tries to defend this knucklehead. And me, I'm just going all off the deep end. So we came to the agreement that we wouldn't have these discussions at all, and we do just fine. But I'm sorry, he's just got to go. I can think of almost anyone who would be a better choice.
Yeah. well, listen, we're going to have to wrap up soon. So I'm going to say thank you. Just thank you for this time. And thank you for sharing this. And then I want to, you know, we just had a comment, except Kanye West.
Yeah. You listen, there's something wrong with him, and I just chalk it up. And I'm sure that most folks can see that. He's got a problem, and it ain't got nothing to do with the White House or nothing else. Something wrong.
Figuring out what's wrong with those other folks who were at the RNC the first night that were used as kind of representatives. I'm sorry, Celia, go ahead. I couldn't resist saying something.
Yeah, no, please.
No. I was going to ask you if you had any questions before we have to close out, if you had any questions for Ms.
Sure. Sure, thank you. And just really quickly, I want to tell you, Mr. Whitaker, I really enjoyed this interview. You know, we've done a few interviews along the way. Your name came up a lot. You know, Celia emphasized that too. Many people talked about you like these really, I think, impressive ways. I mean, and I remember with your friend Johnny, he said, you know, well, Whitaker was, he was more intellectual. I really could see it. I understand, you know. And then you talked about the dynamic. Celia asked you questions about YouTube, and you talked about Fire and Ice. That was pretty cool. That was really interesting to hear about your journey. And frankly, I just want to say thank you. I think that you did incredible work leading. I was really blown away by your story, and I think that one of the most poignant moments was when you talked about, you know, carrying your books and not thinking about anything but just getting out of school, and you saw your friend in trouble.
I mean, I think that was the mindset of most people that day. None of us came to school that day looking for what ultimately went on. What we didn't know is that the police had massed in the neighborhood, and they were ready from the first minute to converge on the school. We had no idea, whatever. And things just kind of happened haphazardly. They didn't know. They were scared. Like I say, when they brought that boy out and he had his arms all pinned behind his back and he looked at me like he was about to cry, he said, help me with, what could I do? I couldn't not. You know, I'm supposed to be one of the leaders. So I threw my books down and I jumped on this cop. And the cop was as scared as me, if not more so. And we wrestled down to the front of the school and he slipped his hand up and caught me. But after that, after he hit me, he didn't try to grab me or anything. He took off. He's scared. He's like, I'm through with this. And we didn't know that all of this had been part of a plan. It was bigger than us. And we didn't know that. And we didn't know that things had been mapped out for us. And there were bigger demons with bigger plans. Like I say, there was Charles Ross, and then that guy, like I say, he was a city attorney or whatever. He's busy trying to be a city leader. And we just fit into his plan. And he used us to springboard himself. Charles Ross the same. Not taking anything away from the man, but after that, that's when they had that big, he had that big court appearance, and it was so big that they moved it out of the courthouse, moved it way out on West Broad Street, out at the Department of Transportation, all that kind of stuff. It was just a lot of political machinations going on that we weren't aware of. Our concern was just getting out of Linda McKinley in one piece, which we very nearly didn't do. And then, like I say, everybody in our senior class, every last single class member graduated. You ever heard of that? Nobody failed. Nobody failed, Don. They graduated, everybody in that class. I checked.
One thing I want to just jump in really, really quickly is that I was also really happy for you, and I think it's a powerful moment. It's very fortunate that even after you wrestled with that cop, that he fled and that you were able to leave and get help, because who knows how that could have affected your life.
Oh, my God, yes.
I mean, you went on to college, and you talked about Central State and the reality there. I think that's really powerful. There's a number of additional questions I would love to ask you, and I'd love it if I could follow up with you at another time.
Sure.
But right, thank you so much. But right now, what I wanted to ask is, as you talked about your story, you talked about your uncle being the pastor of the church that you attended regularly, even though you couldn't be there that night for the event, and you talked about you're the first person who really, I think, in the interviews that I've been a part of, has shared the idea that the police that there was already a plan in motion before you got to school that day, that the police were already massing in the neighborhoods, prepared to act regardless of what might happen. And that just shows a different level of insight. I mean, thinking about strategically about what was going on. And so I'm thinking about your role in activism. And I'm wondering, is there anything that you read along the way while you were in high school, maybe before or during this time, that inspired you to get involved? Anything in particular that really made you become a leader and get involved in activism?
It's difficult for me to speak to that. It was just that at the time, I felt it incumbent upon me to speak up. I saw some things going on. I wasn't the only one. There were a number of us who were becoming involved. We were forging our own way and making the path for ourselves. And I just felt that that I should. For some reason, I need to speak up. I need to say something. Now, Johnny Wells had a lot to do with that, because I always felt like I needed to cool him out. If we left it up to Johnny, Lyndon would have been in flames. I don't mean to make him sound crazy, whatever. You know, Johnny Wells is a very intelligent guy, but at times he could get a little ahead of himself. Yeah, and he would just let his emotions take over and woo.
I think that's powerful. And maybe you guys balanced each other in some way.
I think we did.
That, you know, had that Malcolm and Martin thing going on.
I think we did.
Wrestled back and forth a little bit, but you still had both had, like, Malcolm and Martin had the same goals, but maybe had different roads, right? One was more open to the idea of militant action, where one was completely nonviolent within the system.
You have to excuse me, man. I got to use this restroom again. You have to excuse me. I'm getting old. I'll be right back.
No problem.
I hit pause on the record. I think I'm good with questions.
Okay. Simone, did you have anything for him?
I just had two. One's more of a comment. The other one is a question, though.
Okay. So then when he comes back. I think at least one person did talk about the police being in the neighborhood. And I can't remember. It might have been Valora Washington, but at least one person did mention that.
I remember that, too. The idea of mentioning them being in the neighborhood. We're right. There's one other person that did say that.
Hidden in plain sight.
I think maybe the difference with Mr. Whitaker is that he was quite explicit about the connection. They were massing to move on to school.
Yeah.
He was quite direct. And I guess the only other question I really wanted to ask, I asked about reading, but I wanted to ask, just phrase it a little differently and say, well, were there any speeches that you heard or anything you saw in the news related to it that inspired you? But it seems like he answered it quite clearly. He was like, hey, I feel like I needed to do something.
Mm-hmm. Indeed.
Might be fun to see him and Johnny Wells together.
That'd be some B-roll right there.
And as soon as we wrap up, folks, I'm going to just run over and meet them to help get him out, okay?
Oh, sure, yeah.
Candace said that she's... I don't think Candace understands. She said she thinks that I can just use my research account, which typically I could. I wouldn't even have to think twice about it. But I don't think I can just use my research account. I think the business office is going to have to approve me using my research account. So I think that, we certainly can tell them to, if they submit their receipts, that we will put in a request. I just can't guarantee it until... until it's in that process, and either they will approve it or they won't. I would think they would approve something like that. It's such a small amount, relative to some of the kinds of requests that they get. But I don't know. I just don't think Candace is hearing that they no longer have access to our research accounts in the way that we used to.
I apologize, you guys, having to rush out like that. I've gone all morning long and been fine. And then suddenly, boom.
It's no problem. No problem at all. We're just glad to have you here.
Yeah. As a warning to you, dear, after you get over the age of 50, things change.
I just found out, so yeah.
And you have no control.
Sure. If that's okay, all right.
Yeah, that's fine.
So, Alan or Simone, whichever.
Let me just wrap up really quickly. So, I asked you about if there was anything you read along the way that might have inspired you to get involved. I mean, you were such a leader. You were very engaged, and it seemed like it was in you. There was something that was inside you that caused you to really want to get involved. So, I wonder if there was anything that maybe not that you read, maybe it wasn't what you were reading, Malcolm X or something else, but perhaps it was something a speech you heard or something that you saw in the news around that time. Was there anything like that that might have affected your engagement, got you motivated, thinking about, or perhaps it was growing up in the church? I'm wondering, what got you involved?
I don't know that it was one thing in particular. Like Don, I did a lot of reading. Malcolm X is one of my heroes from way, 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 way back. From very early on. And I read everything I could about him, by him. Of course, there were several other people that I had read about. It was also a time in this country when there were other movements. CORE, the Black Panthers, It was just the things that were going on in the United States in general. And there were a lot of African-American groups, you know, that spoke to the issues during that time period. And like I said, it wasn't just Columbus, Ohio. It was this entire nation. And that was the attitude during that time. In fact, we kind of felt in Columbus that we were a little behind times because some things had happened a few years prior to that affected all of us. But then we had this big issue, you know, at Lyndon McKinley. But it was the whole city that was involved. It wasn't just us. Everybody in the city had an opinion, had a viewpoint. I'm not sure why I became as involved as I did. I just felt it necessary to speak up, open your mouth, speak about the things you see that are going on. And being at Lyndon McKinley provided that opportunity for me. It was nothing planned. It just came about. Like I said, I remember at the beginning of the school year, just like Don told you, when Mr. Brown threatened to kick him out of school, he threatened me too. He looked at me one day and said, "You want to go to Central?" I'm looking at him like, "Are you crazy?" But this was the attitude that he came in with. That was his purpose in being there. He's a black man, so they get a black administrator, and he did kick a lot of guys out of school. But his attitude gradually changed over the course of that one school year, you know, our senior year. And I think that it was because he was impressed by us as an organized group of young people who were able to come together and with differing viewpoints express our views, because we all wanted the same thing as it, you know, when it all boiled down. And like I said, me and Johnny Wells, yeah, we were fire and ice. Oh man, if you could have been at some of those meetings, because Johnny was always, you know, and my point was always, okay, well then what are we gonna do? You know, why, what's the plan? You know, to me, there had to be a plan. Johnny was like, you know, the hell with it, just tear something up. He calmed down right after we got out of high school. But like I was telling Don the story of Johnny came to know some folks. Remember that kid that killed Dr. Martin Luther King's father down in Atlanta? He shot him in his own church, Martin Luther King Sr. Well, Johnny, I know we got out of school, Johnny kept wanting me to go down to Atlanta with him. And one of the people that he was gonna meet with in Atlanta was that kid. I didn't go. You know, something told me, no, no, you don't want any part of this. And I stayed away from that. But this is a guy that Johnny was associating with, and people like that. But this kid, yeah, he killed Martin Luther King Sr. in his church. Shot him. I know you're a little young yet, but yeah, that took place. How old are you? I'm guessing that you're not over 50.
Why did he do that? Do you know why?
It was never discovered why. I think because he was just nuts. I mean, you know, come on, he shot the pastor in his own church, a black pastor, and he's a black guy. What could possibly have been the point? You know?
And a very famous one is that involved in social justice, so that's crazy. At Ebenezer Baptist Church, which is one of the biggest churches in Atlanta.
Thank you.
That was his father's church.
Thank you. And it was long after that time.
He must not have killed them.
Huh?
Right? He must not have killed them.
Yeah, he did.
Until 1984.
Well, it was 84.
Oh, so it was well after you graduated from high school.
No, it wasn't that long after I graduated from high school. It wasn't 1984. It was still in the 70s.
We might be thinking of different things, too.
So
let me ask you one thing. I want to just bring this back real quick to one other point. One of the things that you said that was really, really powerful, you talked about Mr. Brown basically going from an enforcer who had been selected by the administration to an ally, to someone who saw you guys as maybe he thought you were knucklehead kids at first, the way you described the high school kids, but you showed him that you were organized and focused. Did you see that as a transformation from enforcer to ally, or how would you describe
it? It was clearly visible, because his attitude when he first came to Linden was he's kicking butts left and right. Say he kicked a lot of guys out of school. He threatened me, he threatened Don with being, with expulsion, you know, from Linden. But as the year progressed and things progressed, you could look at him and see the differences in his train of thought. He wasn't the great enforcer anymore. He made it possible for us to meet in the teacher's lounge. You know, he did that. No one else but him. And you could look on his face and see the concern that he had for us, for the whole student body. It was a visible change. He's somebody I came to, I didn't necessarily like him very much at the beginning of the school year, but he's somebody I came to respect by the end of that school year.
Senior's wife who was murdered.
Right. I'm sorry.
He was after the husband, but he wasn't there at church that day.
Right.
And so instead he shot her while she was
I'm sorry. Her. Yes, it was her. But he went into that church. And
crazy.
Yes. And these were the kinds of people that Johnny was associating with.
Black ministers are black menace to black people. That's what he said.
I didn't know these guys, and he always wanted me to meet some of them. He tried to encourage me to go to Atlanta with him, where I would have met this guy. But for some reason, I'm like, nah, I don't think so. And then very shortly thereafter, this took place.
It was 1974.
Yeah, and these were some of the people, and by that time, I'm in the military anyway, so. But these were some of the kinds of people he was associating with. It just made me want.
Two questions. One, it sounds like your impression of Dr. Ross was that he was opportunistic.
Yes.
But I just wondered if you realized that he lived on Duxbury, that he lived down the street from the school. I don't think it was across from the school, but I think it was he definitely lived on Duxbury from what his son said.
I don't doubt, I didn't know that. I don't doubt that he was from the community. He was one of the few people that became interested in us early on, but he wasn't there from the very beginning of our struggles, you know, not through the school year. He showed some interest in us when things had started to happen after that day at the school when they had the police all up there. He's one of the, in fact, he was the only one who came up there, came up to the school to see about what was going on with us. I'm not saying that he wasn't concerned, but I think his greater concern with what was going on this campus as opposed to us. You know what I mean? There were a lot of people that weren't, and a lot of people that kind of wanted to, we were just high school kids. And as far as a lot of people were concerned, just high school kids raising Cain. There were very few that took some serious time to listen to anything we had to say. And that was discouraging. Because
right.
We felt differently and we knew better.
So my other question is, what do you think is the power in the black nationalist flag that it would produce such a strong and forceful response? Because right, like one, it was put up on the roof and it was taken down, but then the next day it was what put up in the auditorium.
Yes.
That right, and you know, and that, and so, and you said that the police were basically on standby, so I'm assuming that was in response to the evening before, the events of the evening before. So what do you think was so because I know that there were other schools that had some issues prior to 71. starting in 69, various schools. A lot of it was around wanting Black History Month. A number of them wanted Malcolm X's birthday to be celebrated.
Yes.
I don't think I recall the flag coming up as much, but you know, obviously this flag was particularly threatening, perhaps more so than Black History Month. Do you have any sense of why it caused such a forceful response?
Well, because it was forceful. And I think that it was recognized by communities outside of our own how forceful it was. It was our rallying point. Much as the flag of the United States of America is to some other people. At that time, this was our rallying point. When we saw that flag, we knew that it belonged to us. This represented us. And for that reason, I think it was hated. And as far as some people are concerned, they would have been pleased to see it stomped out of existence. But for us, it was the rallying point. This is the thing that we rally behind. This is us. This represents us, all of us. All of us Black folks. And this is what we're going to stand by and stand behind. And I think that was hated vehemently. There's been a long period of time in the United States, perhaps throughout its history, where they always try to adhere to this notion that we're all so happy and we're all just getting along and there ain't no problems to worry about. And it's not the truth. It's never been the truth of this country. And you know, we as Black folk have always sought some singular point, something singular to rally behind. And that flag is that rallying point. And there are a lot of people in this country that just felt that it was disrespectful to the flag of the United States. It's not like we're not citizens and that we don't respect the United States, but here's something that belongs to us. This is what we're made of. This is what we're made from. This is ours, and we can represent that. And for some reason, that notion has been a hated notion for a very long time. And the idea behind it has never been dealt with honestly. There are a lot of things in this country that just haven't been dealt with honestly. That's why we're having the conflicts that we're having now. You know, like I was telling a young lady earlier, it looks no different today than it did those 50 years ago. And that's ridiculous. We're 50 years on, and here we are. Why is that? Because they're just issues that just have not wanted to be dealt with. And so they weren't. It's real easy to shuffle us to the side and not pay attention. Things are a little different now. Everybody got a cell phone. So, you know, you can take pictures of stuff going on. These things going on, but these Black men being assaulted and shot down by the police, that's not new. That's been going on for a very long time. But now everybody can see it. And I mean everybody. It's on your nightly news. So you can't, you know, and there are some people, a lot of white people are like, oh my God. What are they doing? Because they didn't know. They didn't have to see it before. But now you can't escape it. So what do you do about it? I don't know. This is a battle for my children and grandchildren. You know, I've gotten a little old. I'm too old to be out there in the street raising my fist and doing anything like that. But I am very concerned about my children and my grandchildren. And the world that my grandchildren have inherited, you know, what's it going to be? And what are they going to be able to do with it?